Hey everyone, welcome to church today. If you're joining us live for the first time, please say hi in the chat. Let us know where you're watching us from. Speaking of the chat, did you know that if you're watching on our website platform, not everything needs to be in the public chat? If you have a question you're not comfortable asking in public, please click on the name of any of our hosts and you'll see a little link that comes up where you can instigate a private chat with them. Need to recognize a host? It's super easy. They just have the word host right next to their name. We'd love to connect with you, answer any questions you might have. Last week, Melanie told us about our Be Christmas Community Serve projects. This Christmas season, we really want to show the love of God to the people around us. And one way that you can serve, even if you don't live anywhere near a Bridgepoint campus, is by signing up to ring a bell for the Salvation Army. You can do this all over the country. I've done it the last couple of years and it's been such a great experience. I would love for those of us who do it this year, if we would post pictures and tag them Be Christmas. That way we can see who is a part of our church family and where you guys connect with us from. We're about ready to start. So again, if you're joining us live, please jump in the chat and say, hey, we would love to meet you. Enjoy the service.
And Merry Christmas, BridgePoint. How are we doing today? All right, so who's excited that it's the Christmas season? I am too. So Tyler, listen, I don't know if you know this, but at the end of October, something magical happens that's not Halloween. Do you know what that is?
I do not, no. I am really right now focused on Christmas, not Halloween time.
Yes. Well, to let you know, the Hallmark Channel starts airing Christmas movies like right around Halloween, right? And listen, I got to do this in the first service, and so I just, the truth will set you free is what I'm told. So I just want to stand before you as my church family and say, I love Hallmark Christmas movies, all right? I love how predictable they are. I love knowing what's going to happen, and I'm going to own that right now.
Yeah, so that didn't come out during our run-through, and it kind of caught me off guard in the first service. I suppose my only response is, you recognize that you've now broadcast that to our whole church family, and you can't take that back. You're comfortable with acknowledging that.
I'm good with that, yeah.
Yeah, I know a lot of people that are just emotionally unstable that really love the Hallmark Channel and those movies for a reason. And as I think about it, I see where you get it.
Well, listen, we are...
Got a couple people there.
Yeah, it's all right. Listen, I'm okay owning it. And listen, because it's the Christmas season, we are so excited that, you know, we're getting ready to start our Christmas series today, To Be Christmas. And hey, listen, if you have kids that are in Kids Point, you gotta tune into what we're doing at Kids Point for Christmas, because I'll tell you, in the first service I only said two, but there are actually three people on this stage right now that are very important parts of the Christmas story with Kids Point, and I'm not gonna say who they are, but it's Kevin, me, and Tyler.
The only problem with that as we get excited about Christmas is, Rick, you've lost all your credibility in front of the crowd because you openly admitted you love the Hallmark Christmas movies. So allow me to say Merry Christmas. Welcome, BridgePoint. Glad that you're here to celebrate Christmas with us. Hey, if it's your first time at BridgePoint, welcome. We're really glad that you're here. We have a little table right against the wall in our atrium that if it is your first time, stop by there on the way out. We actually have a little gift we'd like to give you. If you're online, make sure you communicate and chat with one of our hosts just so we can properly thank you for tuning in to what God's doing around here. We're just excited to celebrate Christmas and all that it means. Am I right?
Oh, I'm excited. Are we going to start celebrating now?
I think so. How about this? If you're online, why don't you chat, communicate, type in there, Merry Christmas. If you're in the room, it's COVID, so don't make it weird, but wave at somebody, shout over your mask, Merry Christmas, and let's stand and we'll keep singing together, okay?
All right, church, let's go ahead and stand together. This is a Christmas carol I'm sure that you're familiar with, so let's all sing the words and praise Jesus this morning.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive a King. Let every heart prepare Him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and heaven and nature sing. We will sing, sing, sing.
Put your hands together, church, come on.
Joy to the world. We will sing, sing, sing.
Joy to the world.
Amen. You guys can have a seat. Sorry. So Romans 15:13 says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust him so that you can overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. That hope is what we're celebrating today, what we're kicking off as a church in this Christmas season. But guess what? We don't get to just come and celebrate that hope here in a worship service, whether you're in this room or watching us online. We actually get to go out and be that hope out in our community. If you've been reading our emails, if you've been following us on social media, then you know that we're kicking off a season of called Be Christmas, where we actually can go out into our community and serve and love our community in very, very tangible ways. If this is news to you, make sure that you check your emails. If you're not getting them, let us know. Just come see us out in the atrium so that we can connect you. We've connected with organizations out in our community that are meeting very, very tangible needs in our community. And there is an opportunity for us to go out and serve our community every single day between now and Christmas. I cannot encourage you enough to take advantage of the opportunities that we're giving you to go out and be Christmas in a world and in a time that so desperately needs it. That's hope. That's the hope that we celebrate. As you, as we worship God through our giving, in this moment, we worship God through our giving to invest in the mission that God has called us on here at BridgePoint. We exist to help people, all people, get closer to God. Thank you for the ways that you're investing in people and with your resources so that we can go out and be hope to a community that desperately needs it. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the hope that you have given us in Jesus. Thank you that we can sing and celebrate that. Thank you that we have an opportunity to go out and live that hope out in our community. Would you open our hearts and our minds to what you have in store for us today so that we can walk out of this room or turn off our computer, however we're connecting, and go out and be more hopeful and have more peace so that it overflows and out into a world that so desperately needs to know the gift that you gave us in your son, Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
All right, Merry Christmas, BridgePoint. How are we doing? Awesome. Online, I hope you're chatting in. Merry Christmas. We finally get to say it. It is appropriate. We're past Thanksgiving, so the debate is settled. Now we can be all in on Christmas, even if you have issue with that. I feel like biblically it says you have to wait till Thanksgiving before you can start celebrating, but we don't have to have that conversation now, all right? We're there. Starting a new series today called Be Christmas. Man, if ever our world needed Christmas, it's never needed it more than it does now. 2020 has been that year. So at BridgePoint, we've been planning and preparing. We have been so excited to get to this series. We've been so excited to finish out 2020 so strong and so demonstratively in our community of being Christmas that we're thrilled for that, thrilled that you're here, thrilled that we get to celebrate. One of the greatest gifts that God is giving to our church in this season is the gift of an opportunity to permanently own a physical campus in Seminole. We are so pumped about that. God is doing miracles on our behalf to get that that story ready for us, that building ready for us, to further the mission, to further the kingdom, to advance and help Seminole, the beaches, and Largo to know of the good news of Jesus, about why not only Christmas matters, but what Christmas set up for us. That is a miracle. I want you to know, you can actually go to the BridgePoint website, click on information about Seminole, hear the story, hear the miracles that God's already doing to make this opportunity possible for us. But we're to the part of the story where the only thing that's left is for us to respond in generosity towards the way God has responded so generously to us, the way he has provided so generously to us. In fact, this Tuesday across our country is known as Giving Tuesday. It follows, always follows the consumeristic nature of Black Friday, of which I fully participated in digitally. But Giving Tuesday is the response to, if Black Friday is all consumer, Giving Tuesday is a way to respond to that. So at BridgePoint, Giving Tuesday will be for Seminole. This is our opportunity to put our money where our mouth is, to respond in faith, trusting that God's not only providing this for us, but wants to use all of us collectively towards that. Here's why that matters. You can actually go to the same website, go to BridgePoint's website, click on Seminole. You can see the dashboard of what we've raised funds-wise so far and the gap from our goal for that. It is my hope. It is our hope as a church. It is our belief as a church that if you and your family will spend time praying and asking God, how do we respond to your generosity related to Seminole? We believe he'll give you a number to invest into that opportunity, to invest into the kingdom work that he wants done in Seminole. And so we trust that'll happen. It's our hope that on Tuesday, your family is ready to either actually give. You can do that online through the BridgePoint app. You can do it now if you want to. Or your family can make a pledge, because maybe your family is similar to mine, that you're not sitting on a ton of extra cash this time of year to be able to invest it, but you know you want to be a part of that. You can pledge to, in a month or over the course of next year, that you'll invest and commit resources towards that campus in a way that responds to God generously. So I hope by faith you're praying about that. I hope by faith you're not only seeing the miracles involved with it, but you're saying, how could I not get behind what God is doing? As if all of that wasn't good enough, a Bridgepoint donor has stepped up and said his family will match dollar for dollar up to $1 million of every dollar given for the Seminole campus. That is a miracle. And then, yeah, that's worth celebrating. And then the Seminole campus folks have taken it upon themselves to schedule for the past week all the way through the end of the year, at least one person or one family will be on that physical location praying for God's provision for that building and property in the morning and the afternoon every day until the end of the year, just so that they'll pray that God will continue to work in our hearts. The thing that they are praying for is for you and I to respond to God generously. So I hope you're praying about your family as my family is praying about mine, about how we can respond to that. If the mission, if the vision, if the miracle of this opportunity is not enough for you and your family to want to invest in it, then I have no problem shamelessly begging you that because today is my birthday, in lieu of a gift, would you please invest in that campus for us, okay? So if mission isn't good enough, do it for Tyler, okay? I'm kidding. Oh, yes, yes, yes. No. We don't need all the attention. It's bad enough to have to acknowledge it publicly, okay? I do it for Seminole, all right? Seminole, I got your back. Man, God is so at work in the life of our church and what he's doing in and through us. It's just powerful. But this year, for us as a church, as we've been praying, as we've been planning, it was not enough for us to just say, we're going to decorate, we're going to prepare, we're going to celebrate Christmas. By the way, massive shout out to Julie Sardelli. She's on our team. She led the charge to decorate Tyrone and downtown. And is it not beautiful? Unbelievable job. Julie's part of our events and facilities team. This was her brainchild that if you stepped onto our campus and didn't feel Christmas hitting you, something's wrong with you, my friends. Stop by, get in the sleigh, grab a picture out in front of the tree out front. Thanks, Julie, for that. But it wasn't enough for us as a church, as we were even planning, and obviously we're going to celebrate Christmas as a church. It wasn't even enough this year to have that hope because, man, like I said when I opened, our world so desperately needs Christmas this year. Our world so desperately needs the hope of what this season is about. Our world needs to know that joy is possible. Our world needs to know that peace is possible. Our world needs to know that God loves them now more than ever because we've lived in a season of such uncertainty, of fear and of chaos and of election confusion and attack and frustration and everything that weighs into that, of just the anxiousness of it all, of how do you navigate it? What do you do with it? What do you do when your neighbor says those things that so staunchly disagree with your perspective? What do you do with friends and family that are either just paralyzed in fear or trying to be insanely wise and balancing that versus trying to live by faith in these types of things? What do you do with the wide range of perspectives, and how do you navigate it if ever we've needed something to remind us of the hope that God is still in control? We need it now. We need Christmas. That's why for this year alone, you get a pass if you started celebrating before Thanksgiving. Again, it's just a personal thing, okay? But it's not enough this year. It's not enough to just celebrate Christmas. I'm talking to those of you that are all in on Jesus, followers of his. We must be Christmas because the world is watching. The world is searching. Every human heart is looking for something more than what our culture has been able to offer them in this year of 2020. And today, as we begin this new series called Be Christmas, today I just want to submit to you the possibility, and it's just a possibility, but what if everything that your longing, hungry heart is searching for? Do you hear that? What if everything that your longing, hungry heart is searching for can be tied back to the story of Christmas? What if everything you're searching for has an answer that can be found in the story of Christmas? That's why I feel like this next season, to wrap up this calendar year of 2020, is so critical for our church to make a statement to Pinellas County and literally to the ends of the earth of the power of why we celebrate Christmas. There's also some of you that are entering into Thanksgiving and now the Christmas holiday season that it's adding stress. You feel that much more anxiety. You're asking yourself, do I have to hang out with my family again in less than a month? Do I have to be around these people? Do I have to go shopping? Do I have to navigate this? Do we have to listen to that uncle rant about that political opinion? Do I have to deal with this? What about all this pressure? What about all this weight? And then how do we do that in a pandemic? And how does it affect things? And I'm going to be missing people that normally I'm so looking forward to seeing at this time. And all of the complexities that come with this year. If you walked in or tuned in today, not ready for Christmas, or so ready for Christmas. If you walked in or tuned in today and you know that deep in your heart it's longing for something and it's not finding it in culture, it's not finding it even in the decorations maybe this year, can I ask you just to lean in with me to the possibility that what your heart, and if I'm honest, what my heart is searching for is found in Christmas. Here's what I mean. I want to walk with you. If you're familiar with the biblical story of Christmas from the Bible, obviously at all, you kind of know the gist of it. The Creator Almighty God holds the whole world in His hand. He created everything. He saw His people living, but He saw His people walking with the weight of sin, walking with the weight of imperfection. I don't need to convince you as much as I don't need you to convince me that I have missed the mark. God saw us carrying that weight, the brokenness that exists inside of us, and Creator at Christmas time inserted Himself into creation. What a wild story. What a miracle in and of itself. God became human flesh to live among us. That's the story and the power of Christmas. That baby at the OG Christmas, that's original Christmas for those of you that are over 40, at the original Christmas, that baby Jesus changed everything. And it has the power to change everything for you today and for the next few weeks if you'll lean into this story. That's why I'm excited about it. But it starts with a prophecy. It starts with a prophecy in Isaiah. That's where I want to begin the story today. I want you to lean in with me to this story because here's why this matters. God, in the Old Testament before Jesus came, would actually speak to His people through prophets. They were almost like the prophet would be a mouthpiece for God. And in this instance, God spoke to Isaiah. Isaiah spoke it to God's people, and it gave them hope because Isaiah's people lived in a world that, quite frankly, was often hopeless. It was dark. It was lonely. They questioned if God saw them. They questioned if God was still at work. They questioned if God was big enough to handle their real life problems. They questioned if their things of faith that had been passed down to them for generations were too childish to hold the weight of real life adult issues. They walked through anxious times. They walked through scary times. They walked through uncertain times. They walked through times where they were really wondering, God, where are you in the midst of all that? Does that sound familiar? Does it sound a little bit like what our year has been? God's people were walking through not the pandemic part, but the confusion and the chaos of the times. And then God spoke through the prophet Isaiah. In fact, one biblical commentator describes the setting in which Isaiah presented this scripture I want to read to you as this. It said, there was no hope for God's people in anything made by people at the time. And I just thought, man, I know a year that certainly sounds a whole lot like that, 2020. And then God spoke. Listen to what God says through Isaiah. If you're familiar with the Christmas story at all, maybe this will be familiar. If you're not familiar with this story, then lean in, whether regardless of what it is, lean in. And I want you to hear what God is saying, possibly even to you this morning. Isaiah chapter 9, starting in verse 6, it says, a prophecy, for to us a child is born. That was to come. That was what they were waiting on. That was the hope they needed to hear. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called, this is big time, look at this, his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. To be walking in a dark and hopeless time and get just a little sense of something that you could hang your hat on as a follower of God, of all the wondering of saying, God, are you out there? God, do you see this? God, what do I grab a hold of in a time like this? Isaiah's words had to have been the anchor that God's people were saying, man, we needed to hear that God was still at work. And he continues that passage by saying this, of the increase of this child's government and of peace, the increase of peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, that's referencing back for God's people at the time, the history that God was still at work, the plan that was still in play, on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. To walk in Isaiah's day in such a time that was so heavy, so dark, so confusing, so anxious, so wondering if God was even still at work, this was the breath of fresh air that those people desperately needed. I don't know what you tuned in or walked in today needing in your soul. I don't know what your heart is searching for. I don't know the specific weight that you're carrying. I just know that it's been a miserable year. This is why I'm begging all of you, lean in to the possibility that this is exactly the passage God Almighty wants you to hear today. Because that promised child, that baby, might just be the answer your heart is longing for. Did you catch the name? Did you catch what Isaiah said this baby was going to be known by, known for, described as? I don't want you to miss the weight of that, because as God was speaking through Isaiah, I think that matters even to us, that Isaiah was saying this baby that is to come, he's going to be known as a wonderful counselor. Anybody ever needed or desired a wonderful counselor? In other words, could this baby really be the ultimate guide for our lives? Hey, parents, speaking as one, have you ever wished that there was somewhere you could turn to just seek out wisdom and answers to do your best in raising your kids? What if it's tied into who God was and is? Hey, anybody that's ever been in a relationship or navigated difficult relational circumstances or been married, have you ever looked for the manual on that? Have you ever been the type of person that's wondered, is there any solving the complex infrastructure known as the female mind? Have you ever been so simple of a human being that you've wondered why people view you as such a fool and yet you're just a man? What if it's tied specifically back to who God is making us to be? What if it's tied back to him saying, I have plans, I have purpose, I have design, I have a game plan for your specific life? What if in the moments where you're wrestling, do I take that job? Do I leave this job? Is that my next? Is this the plan? God, would you send me a billboard? God, would you write something in the clouds? God, would you please just give me wisdom? And God's trying to say, I have. I want to be that counselor for you. If you've walked through hard times, if you've walked through uncertain times, if you've walked through difficult seasons and you've just wondered how to navigate life, what if the plan from the beginning was to show you what life looks like in the form of Jesus living his life of love? But it wasn't just wonderful counselor that the baby would be known by. He'd be known as Mighty God. In other words, what if God gave us something big enough to stake our lives on? Because if we're honest, how many of you walked in or tuned in today feeling the weight of the world completely on your shoulders? That for months, if not years, you've put on a brave face. That you've picked it up every day, that you've done your best, that you put on a smile, or that you've handled it as best you possibly could, knowing that none of us have done this before. And that you're trying every day, but if you're honest, if you're really, really honest, today when you walked in, you felt like you weren't sure where the next step was going to land, where the next breath was going to come from. You felt like you've been brave for so long, But when's the point that you get to take a breath and that somebody's brave for you? What if the point was never that we have to carry the full weight of our world on our shoulders as if we're capable of that anyway? What if Christmas was intended to be the reminder that God gave us an anchor, that when life starts to toss, when life starts to turn, when life gets chaotic and confusing and dark and filled with anxiousness, that there's a space we can go to that will be constant. What if that baby was to remind us of that? That being mighty God was the reminder that we can build our lives on a foundation that won't fail. Remember his name, though? It didn't even stop there. It called Everlasting Father. I know for some of you, to bring up the idea of Father doesn't come with pleasant thought. Doesn't come with happy memories. But this isn't a comparison to just an earthly father. This is an everlasting father who's completely good and completely just. A father that promises to never leave or forsake, to never abandon or disappear, to never shirk his duties of being present and involved and with you. What if in the midst of this world, part of why he's identified as an everlasting father is because it's a reminder that God holds our whole world and the whole world in his hands. That he wants to do this life with us. That it wasn't just to spin your world into creation and step back so that he could judge or correct or shame you for the ways you didn't get it right, but instead, as an everlasting father, to be present, to be with you, and to be strong for you when you and I can't be strong enough for ourselves. There's hope there. But that isn't even where the name stopped. Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Does 2020 point to our world's desperate need to find peace or what? What if Christmas is the reminder that knowing Jesus, that baby, that God in human flesh was that deep, soul level rest and satisfaction that so many of us are searching for in this world? What if Christmas really was intended not to just be the reason we put up trees and lights and give presents and stuff to everybody? What if Christmas was intended to remind us that actually everything we're searching for is tied into what everything that this holiday is about? That's a powerful thought. I want you to hear a message, the message paraphrase of how the rest of Isaiah's prophecy finished out. Because it wasn't just a description of the coming Christmas child of Jesus that was to come for the people. It wasn't just that that gave them hope, that anchored their soul. But Isaiah continued it by saying, his ruling authority will grow. Because you can't stop a move of God. And there'll be no limits to the wholeness he brings. You see that? To the broken places in your heart, to the weighty places, to the places where you're tired, where you're worn out and you're weary and you don't feel like you can keep going, there are no limits to the wholeness Jesus can offer your life. Because Jesus didn't come to just fix this earthly thing. Jesus didn't come to just take over. Jesus didn't come to be president. Jesus didn't come to just magically sprinkle pixie dust on us. Jesus came to complete us in a way that this world cannot offer us. And there's no limits to the wholeness he brings. He'll rule from the historic David throne over that promised kingdom. Again, referencing back that this has been God's plan and nothing can stop God's plan. He'll put that kingdom on a firm footing and he'll keep it going with fair dealing and right living, beginning now and lasting always. And then look at this. The zeal of God of the angel armies will do all this. Please don't miss the power of what God is saying, that God will come through for you. That thousands of years when people were in a dark, hopeless, empty, anxious place, they got a promise for God that God would show up for them in a way that they were not expecting. And God did. The baby came. The baby came not like anybody was expecting. And the baby lived his life not like anybody was expecting. It was completely different and completely loving and such a completely refreshingly different way of life that the religious elite couldn't stand it, and they killed him. And the baby died. And they stuck that grown man that the baby had become into a tomb, his lifeless body. But that baby that became the Savior His heart started beating again, and his lungs filled with breath. And in one fell swoop, he defeated sin and death. He defeated our imperfections. He defeated all the ways we cannot measure up to that standard forever, because that baby rose from the grave and now reigns at the right hand of the Father, because God will come through for you. And Christmas is the reminder of the promise that God's going to show up. And in fact, he did. He showed up in Jesus, and he's promised to never leave. In other words, if you hear nothing else I say today, what I want you to understand about Christmas is this big idea, that Jesus came to be hope to people who lived in dark times. And if your journey right now, listen to me, online and in the room, if your journey right now is a dark time, if it's lonely, if it's empty, if it's isolating, if you feel broken, if you feel worthless, cast aside, if you're too addicted, too marginalized, too stuck, too broken, your story's too jacked up to be a part of something more, I need you to understand that that's why Jesus came. And there's not one of us, myself included, that hasn't reached a moment where we need Jesus to show up for us. And Christmas reminds us that he did. Some of Jesus' followers, when he was walking this earth and living that life that was refreshingly different, were eyewitnesses to that, even to his death and his resurrection. They saw him after he'd come back to life. They recorded many of the things that he said, the way that he taught, the way that he loved, the miracles that he did. And one of his followers, Luke, recorded Jesus as saying this in Luke chapter 19, verse 10. These are Jesus' own words. He said, "For the Son of Man," Jesus is talking about himself, "the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." It's like a mission statement. That's why he came to do that. Christmas was the beginning of Jesus' mission to be executed. What was the mission? Seeking and saving the lost. And sometimes we tie up too much weirdness or mysticism into the idea of the lost. What does that mean that Jesus came for them? And I want us to understand this Christmas, the purpose of Jesus' coming, that the lost is anyone that has felt confused, tossed, disillusioned, or hopeless. That's why Jesus came. He came for anybody that's hurting or weary or self-destructed or addicted. He showed up. He came for anyone that's been self-seeking or felt worthless, marginalized, or unseen. Jesus came for the lost, meaning anybody that's felt anxious, empty, afraid, or cast aside. I hope that what I'm doing right here is meeting its purpose, which is simply to point out the fact that all of us, this pastor included, find ourselves desperately in need of a Savior because of the brokenness that's a part of my story and yours. What if Christmas is the reminder that everything our soul is searching for goes right back to this Christmas child? What does he have to do with all this? I am so glad you asked. The Christmas child, if you're in the place where you're feeling confused, tossed, disillusioned, or hopeless, or you know someone that is, then maybe the best gift you can give them is point them to the Christmas child who can be for them what they can't be for themselves, a wonderful counselor. For the people or for yourself that's hurting or weary or self-destructed or addicted, what if the gift you gave to them or to yourself this year is to seek out Jesus even more because he is mighty God? What if for the friend or for the heart that's present or that you know that's self-seeking or feeling worthless or feeling marginalized or unseen like nobody cares, what if the gift you gave to them was to point them back to the Christmas child who is known as an everlasting Father? What if for anyone that's ever felt anxious, empty, afraid, or cast aside, you reminded them that Christmas is the place where they can find the Prince of Peace? That everything our souls are longing for, everything our souls are hurting for, everything that we need in this life is tied to this child, which I think is why this time of year we sing, "Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free." Listen to this. "From our fears and sins release us. Let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation. It's been the plan from the beginning. He's tying back. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art, dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. People walked in darkness and they desperately searched for hope to find anything to hang on to. And the hope they were given is what we now know as Christmas. Jesus came to be Christmas. Jesus came to be with them and therefore to be with us. In other words, Jesus came to be hope to people who lived in darkness. So listen to me, church. Those of you that are following Jesus, those of you that understand what Christmas is about and understand how Christmas in this year of 2020 is so desperately needed for the culture around us, the big idea today, Jesus came to be hope to people who lived in dark times. Be hope. Be hope. It's not enough this year to put up a tree and to put up the lights and celebrate the magic of Christmas, because what our world needs is to see a group of people that are living guided by something that's big enough to hold the weight of their lives, that's bigger than the childhood stories they think they have outgrown God in light of. It's bigger than the weight of this world upon our shoulders. Church, this Christmas, we can't just celebrate it. We must. The world needs us to be Christmas. Can I ask you something? Who needs to see your hope to guide them to his hope this Christmas? Who needs to see your hope to guide them to his hope this Christmas? After 2020, I know you know somebody that needs some hope. After 2020, if we're honest, we could use the reminder of where hope comes from. But here's what I want to point out. Two questions and then I'm done, I promise. See your hope. Two questions. Number one, do you have hope? Do you have hope that in the midst of this year, God is still at work? That God has plans and purpose for your life, meaning to give and assign to you, a plan that's wilder than you could ask or imagine, and something bigger than anything this world could offer us? Do you have hope? Because if not, maybe today, maybe the start of Christmas season begins by saying, I need to know Jesus. I need to know the Christmas child, because hope, I'm lacking it. But let me talk to you, those who have been around Bridgepoint or around church for any length of time. Let me talk to you guys for a minute, followers of Jesus. Can other people see your hope? Like when you post, are you posting hopeful things? When you talk about things, are you talking hopefully? Are you talking about the hope of how God's working for our country, in our world? Are you talking about the excitement of what he's doing? Are you living more in a fearful tone or a judgmental tone or a condemning tone? Because that's not pointing to the hope of what Christmas is about. Our world doesn't need more of that. Our world needs more of Jesus. So this Christmas, maybe it's a neighbor or a family member. Maybe it starts with you and in your own home. Maybe it's a coworker or a classmate or a teammate or a friend. Maybe it's little seeds of hope to the people that are going to get exhausted working retail and providing for those of us that are shopping this year. Maybe it's tangible things in our community through the Be Christmas initiatives that we have of folks that need just a taste of hope that you and I can provide to them, because we know where to find it. This Christmas, it's not enough. It's not enough, church. It's not enough for us to say, yay, Christmas, here's a present. Yay, Christmas, look at the lights and the pretty trees. Yay, Christmas, I love the magic of this time of year. This year, more than ever, let's commit ourselves to be Christmas. And that starts with the hope that Jesus has brought to us. Would you pray with me? God, 2020 has been a year, and don't we know it? God, all of us tuning in or joining in person, all of us have a story, all of us have an experience. Most of us have some hurt, some anxiousness, some confusion, some questions, some uncertainty related to this season, and God, you know all of those. But God, while all of us were caught off guard by 2020, you, God, were not. You, God, still are the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. You, God, are everything that our souls are searching for, whether we want to acknowledge it or not. You, God, have the answers that we feel like we need to manufacture on our own. You, God, are steady and ready for our life's weight and problems. You, God, even loved us enough to make provision for our sin and imperfection. So, God, my hope this Christmas is that we might know where real hope is found. And that's you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you made a way that we would know hope in an otherwise often hopeless feeling world. So Jesus, help us to trust you. In your name we pray, amen. Today's response, I hope, stirs something in your heart. Because if ever our world has been open and desperately searching for what we know to be true about God, it's now. It's right now. It's this year. And everything we're going to celebrate at Christmas is everything our world is searching for. So can I start with this? Are you tuning in today? Are you joining in the room? Can you say 100% positively, absolutely, confidently that you know the hope that is found in Jesus? Do you know Jesus? And if you don't know him today, let's start right there. Online and in the room, we have a prayer and care team that would love to pray with you to introduce you to Jesus. Online, you click a button in the room, out the doors to the right. There's a room right back here called Prayer and Care. Nothing weird that we want to do in that space other than to hear your story and let you know how God's working in it and to pray with you. For the rest of us, I hope as we walk through this message and as we walk through this series that you're thinking of specific people, starting with those you know are living in a real hopeless spot right now. How can you and I be hope for them that points them back to our hope? Maybe it's jumping into an initiative, grabbing some friends, family members, and being a part of the Be Christmas stuff that we have going on. Maybe it's just walking across the street or walking across the living room to pick up the phone or send a text and let people know where the hope you found. But it's not enough just to put a tree up this year, guys. Because our world needs Jesus. So we're going to respond to him. If you need prayer and care, take steps towards that. Otherwise, let's stand and celebrate Jesus together as we sing.
Of ages stepped down from glory.
sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Declare this, church, come on.
Came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the
family. Thank you so much for joining us today. Whether you're hanging out at one of our campuses or online, we are so grateful that you took some time just to be with us today. Amy mentioned it during our offering time, but please this week go online and look at the projects that we have available in our community for us to be Christmas. I can tell you that in the past, I've been guilty of sitting on the sidelines during the Christmas season and just kind of soaking it in and not actually taking an active role in it. But this season, we get to be Jesus and be Christmas to people in our community. Maybe it's something you do with your family. Maybe it's something you do with your small group. I know the small group that I'm a part of, we're actually going to be choosing this week the project that we're going to go jump into and serve in together. And who knows, maybe it becomes a new tradition for you. Maybe it's something that you and your family start to do every year as a way to take an active role in this holiday season. We love you. If you're new here today, if this is your first time here, make sure you stop by our first time guest counter because we have a gift for you. And we cannot wait to see you next week. Merry Christmas, everybody.